My wife has had some long-term health problems, particularly with allergies. And many years ago, she went to a researcher in orthomolecular medicine who showed her a way of testing for allergies. And what this person said, and I think it's called kinesiology or kinesthesiology, basically what it is you hold something that you think you're allergic to, you hold it to your chest, and then you put your arm out and press your arm down, have somebody press your arm down, and if you're allergic to whatever it is you're holding next to you, your arm will weaken. She also showed how you can make an O with your fingers like this, and if you're holding something that you're allergic to and somebody tries to pull the O apart, your muscles will weaken. The other thing that she showed to us was using a pendulum. And let me turn the camera here. What the pendulum is the test for is you put something that you think you're allergic to down and you hold a pendulum over it. And she said if you're allergic to it, the pendulum will swing one way. If you're not allergic to it, then it will swing the other way. One way if your body wants it, one way if your body does not want it. Well, anyhow, my wife came back from the orthomolecular researcher and told me about this stuff, and I thought it was a bunch of nonsense. But then I went to test it, and it all worked. All of it, including the pendulum, which really got me fascinated. So I went online, or not online, at that time we didn't have internet, but I started researching, and I could not find any information at all about what it was, except for a book called Body Electric. There was some information there. But I did my own research on it, and I found out that the body puts out an ion field. And the ion field will radiate down through past the pendulum, and it will actually cause the synapse in the arm to fire to synchronize their movements, either clockwise or counterclockwise, depending upon whether the body does or does not want this. Well, this developed into this little contraption. This is the original stick, and we still use it. We have calcium, magnesium, sodium, potassium, zinc, copper, iron, chromium, and manganese here. And we can then, just by holding the pendulum over it, find out if our bodies want or do not want these, and we can actually test our minerals this way. My body is actually high in these. It wants copper right now. And it looks like a bunch of nonsense, but what we did to verify this was with ourselves, with my wife, and with other people that we worked with. I would take a one strand of hair, the root end, and then I would put one hand on this mineral, and then I would hold this over the hair, and it would go clockwise or counterclockwise depending upon whether my body would want what was in the hair. Reason being is the ion fields, if I touch this, or even if my hand is close to it, because the ion field normally goes about 6 inches if a body is clean. Most people by the age of 20, the ion fields have started to shut down because of the diet and bad health problems. But I keep my body clean as much as I can, and so the ion fields are quite strong. But if I touch this, the ion fields assume that this mineral is already in my body. So the pendulum would then say, if the calcium is in the hair, it would then say no, that it does not want the hair, because I'm already, the ion fields detected I'm high in calcium. And I can go down the list this way and figure out what the hair is high or low into. And what we'll do, we'll take a hair and put it on a 3x5 card, tape it on so that the root end is out and I can test it. And then we write down what I test as far as high and low here. And then we send a larger hair sample off to a laboratory. And it costs us about $200 to get the professional lab results back. And always, 100%, what I find high and low here using the pendulum test is validated by the tissue mineral analysis. So this has proved itself over time to be very, very, very accurate. The other thing that I found that it does is for batteries. If I take a battery and I want to know if it's dead or not, I can hold this over it, and if it doesn't move, then the battery is dead. If my body wants ions coming off of it, like anions or cations, it will move corresponding to whether my body wants or does not want the charge. And the more that the pendulum moves, the stronger the charge is in the battery. And this also has been proven, because when we take batteries out of the fridge, or sometimes even if you buy a battery pack like at Walmart, a lot of them are already dead. But we'll set them out, and I'll test them, and I'll find the dead ones, and you can validate it by putting that into a device, an electric toothbrush or something, and the ones that I have determined are dead, you put them in, they don't work. The ones that I determine have a charge, you put them in, and they work. So this has been proven accurate for testing minerals. It's been proven accurate for testing ion fields. Okay, now let's... I put this into a video called Pendulum Science. It goes into more depth as far as how this works. But then a friend of mine asked me to research organite, which is these resin devices that people are making with coils and crystals and different layering and stuff inside of them. And he gave me an organite device that he had purchased and asked me to test it. And I did not find what the people were claiming. I could not detect the orgone fields that people were detecting, but I did detect ion fields coming out of them. Oftentimes, a splitting of ions, the device would have anions going one way and cations going the other way, and I have to apologize. Scientific people correct me, and they say it's anions, not anions, anions. And it's not cations, it's cations. But I told them, I said, my tongue's too lazy for that, so it's anions and cations, and I apologize if it offends your scientific sensibilities. But anion and cation are just too cumbersome for my lazy tongue. So anions and cations. But the one thing that I did discover also off the organite devices was a crazy field, a tracking field that was coming off the devices. And I put this into my video, The Crazy Organite Discovery. And what I found basically is a carbon based objects, and it doesn't have to be as carbon as this. As a matter of fact, the field is ubiquitous in nature, comes off of almost any animal, particularly any animal that has a snout or antennas. A collector field would go out from the base of this, or let's say this is the nose of a fish or the nose of an animal, right about where the eyes are. The collector field would go out, and a distributor field, a tracking field, will go out this way. And anions will be in the tracking field. There's actually a skin, a sheath that goes around it that repels the anions back in. It's very fascinating, because you can actually take a battery with a good anion charge and hold it close to where this field is coming out, and the field will bend away from it because it repels anions. But anyhow, we tested this out, and these things are very ubiquitous in nature. They're all over the place. And why in the world I'm actually able to detect them, I'm not sure, because the distributor field has a charge to it, and I'm able to follow it quite easily. And the collector field also has a charge to it. It's not positive or negative. It actually is a different sort of energy. But I'm actually able to detect the fields and where they go and what they do. But you can see more in my video of Crazy Organite Discovery if you want to see more of that. And so that was a very, very fascinating research. But then it developed one step further. So now this developed one step further, because I was in my study of organite, I had seen a video of a guy who posted a picture that somebody had given him. And in this photograph, there was a resin pyramid, and I think it was illuminated with LEDs. I'm not exactly sure on that. But in this photo, the distributor field was going up. You could actually see the electrons illuminated inside the distributor field. And it went up out of the photograph, came back down, and then there was an orb at the very end of it. And I kind of chalked that away at the back of my head. And then one day I was thinking about that, and I remembered what this bend of the field meant, because tracking these fields, as you'll see in the Crazy Organite Discovery, the fields, once they attach to something, if that thing moves back in, it takes it a while to bring this field back in, to reel it in. So what this photograph told me was that this orb was way up here, and this thing hit it, and no sooner did it hit it that this thing, the orb, came down. And so the field was yet to be tracked in. You could see the electrons, or the light, the photons from the light still in the tracking field, and the orb was illuminated also. So what this told me basically was two things. One is that this thing is capable of tracking orbs. Secondly, is the orbs appear to respond to being hit by this thing. It appeared that this orb actually came down from a great distance up in the air, almost like to see what in the world was hitting it. So I thought, okay, well, let's give this a try. And I told this thing, I said, find me an orb. Because these things, the way they run is they run for off of a genetic equivalent or a similar, they'll look for something that's very similar to their content, or they will look for a cation charge to distribute an anion charge into in order to balance it out, or they run off of cognitive commands or instinctive commands, as in animals and fish, instincts will run these also. So I can give it a cognitive or verbal command, and I said, find me an orb. And so this thing shot out right out the ceiling. And it's like, whoa, we got something. It hit something, because these things will always hit something. They'll do their best to put together all the commands that they're being given and find you something. So anyhow, this thing located something. You know, so it hit an orb that was somewhere in the ceiling. And I'm thinking, okay, now, now what do I do? Because I don't know if these things will reel it in, you know, like a fishing rod, reel it in. Actually, in this case here, the orb came down on its own. So what I did was I was searching the air. Then I took my pendulum, and I can track the field here, but I was trying to find it in the air. And I was searching all around my in the air around here, and I could not find the orb. I could not find the orb. And so I asked it, I said, please, would you set it into my hand? And I held up my hand, and I was testing it with the pendulum. Nothing, nothing, nothing. After a minute of asking, please set it into my hand, then this thing, I detected this field coming down, and it was as if my hand was right here, and this field stopped a foot away from my hand. And I thought, goodness, I've got an orb in my hand. The field had stopped a foot away from my hand, but I had this thing in my hand, and I thought, well, I can't see it, I can't feel it. Now what do I do? And that's all I did the first day. I thought, well, I gotta think about this, because I don't know what else to do. So that's all I did the first day. The second day, I went and repeated the thing. I told it to find me an orb, and it was a lot quicker that I had an orb in my hand. I said, please come into my hand. And the first day I tested it, I got no ion reading off the orb. Second day I tested it, I detected a cation charge in the orb, which might be one of the reasons that this thing actually is able to hit it, because it tends to go toward cation charges also. I detected a cation charge. And then the third day that I tested it, I actually detected a cation charge with layers inside of it. And I thought, oh, this is really interesting. So then what I did is I took the orb, I asked it to stay in my hand. I had to keep asking it to stay in my hand. And then I took and stood up a coil like this. And what this is just a coil of wire with quarter-inch spacing. And what happens with it is EMF will interface with this, And this is what was happening with a lot of the organite devices, that EMF would interface with it. Anions from the EMF would go one way, cations would go the other way. So what I did is I stood this up onto a, I think it was a pile of blankets or something in my truck. I stood this up, and then I had the orb in my hand, and I passed the orb through the coil. And then I had the pendulum over in the other hand, over here, to detect any EMF interface. And as I passed the orb through the coil, I noticed that there were, at certain intervals, the EMF interface would stop. The ions would no longer come out of it. And what I determined was this here. Let me put it on the carpet. That the orb that I'm dealing with has three layers in it. It's an 11-inch layer shell not superconductor, but a shell that stops an EMF interface, because as I was pushing the orb through the coil, the EMF interface would stop, then it would start, and it would stop, and it would start again, it would stop again, start again, and all the way through. And I tested it time and time and time again to make sure I was getting it right. So if you imagine three balls, and the outside one is 11 inches, the next one is 7 inches, the center one is 3 inches, and I still have to get, because they're 2 inches apart, and the center one is 3 inches, so this size is actually off comparatively, relatively. There might be a fourth ball inside there, but it would be 1 inch thick. So I'm going to have to make myself a coil, a 1 inch coil, and see if I can get in there and see if I can detect if there's actually a fourth ball in there. So there's at least three balls, 11 inches, 7 inches, and 3 inches, all together inside of each other. They have a cation charge with this protective skin that's on it, keeping the cation charge from conducting. The other thing that I found with it is that the orb also has a north pole to it. A north pole, what do you call it, a charge, like the north pole of a magnet. And it must be pulsing at some frequency, because it actually has the effect of a pulsing north pole upon water. So this thing has a pulsing north pole magnetism, and the way I discovered it was interesting, because I did not know how to test these things. I mean, I'm trying to figure out what to do with this thing, what it's for, and you think, well, why are they here? I mean, what do they do? And so I thought, well, maybe they're like a vitamin. And so I took the orb in my hand, asked it to come into my hand, and then I breathed it into my lungs. I thought, well, maybe you take it like a vitamin. Maybe it's supposed to do something internally. And I had it in my lungs for about 5 seconds, and it just felt like it was burning my lungs, so I coughed it back up. And the next day, I actually did it again, because I thought, well, maybe a guy has to just get used to the energy. And so I breathed it in about 5 seconds later, coughed it back up, breathed it back out again. And I actually did it the third day also. But what I noticed then was my ion levels of my body, which I keep close tabs on, they had changed. Where my calcium, magnesium, sodium, potassium, and electrolytes tend to be fairly low, now they were high. Calcium, magnesium, sodium, potassium, and zinc were high. And most of my life, they've been low. And the copper was now low. Most of my life, the copper's been high. It's been something I've had to struggle with, trying to get the zinc up and the copper down. Well, now the zinc was reading up and the copper was down. I thought, well, wait a minute. This thing wouldn't be changing the mineral content, but it could be changing what minerals in my body are fired up as far as the ion activity. But the calcium, magnesium, sodium, potassium, and zinc being fired up, I thought, wait a minute, I've seen this once before. Because a while back, we got this device, and what this is this is a tankless water softener. It has a power cord to it. You plug it in, and it's a transformer. Changes the voltage to a DC volts. And it's got coils in here, so that what the coils do is it pulses south pole, a pulsing south pole, and you wrap this around your water pipes, and it pulses south pole into the water pipes. And what this does is this will take and soften the water, because it will take the calcium, magnesium, sodium, potassium and drop the ion activity out of it so that they do not clog up in your lines. Also, it drops the ion activity out of the zinc. It fires up the ion activity of copper. Well, when we were testing this out, it's like, open this thing up. There. Pardon me a second. When we were testing this out, I thought, well, what would happen if you reversed it and had this toward your body, so the North Pole pulsing into you, would it reverse it? And we tested it on ourselves, and it actually does. It has the exact same readout as what this, same effect as what this gives. Calcium, magnesium, sodium, potassium, and zinc are high, and then the copper is suppressed. So seeing that inhaling this gave me the same electromagnetic effect as this as far as the ion activities, then I started looking to see if this thing has a North Pole charge to it. Excuse me. And then I took a magnet and I held the South Pole to it, and this thing was drawn right to it. So this was really fascinating. So not only does it have a cation charge, it has at least three layers in it, the 7-inch, or the 11-inch, the 7-inch and the 3-inch, but it also has North Pole to it. So we've been studying and studying and studying these things to figure out what they are and what they do, and the research has been going on and on. One of the other things that I noticed with it is that the cation charge inside strengthens or weakens according to my words. If I say yes, 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 the ion charge will strengthen inside of it like an opening of a gate, the opening of a portal. If I say no, 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 it will shut down real quick. And this was really fascinating because we tried out different words to see how it would respond. And this was really fascinating because if you say bless you, please and thank you, it opens up. If you say no, or if you're rude to it, it closes down. As a matter of fact, I did an experiment, one of the first experiments that I did with this thing when I was still calling the orb in. I was asking it politely because I had seen people on the internet that were calling in orbs, but they always said to do it politely. So it's please and thank you. Well, I thought, well, what would happen if I asked rudely? So I demanded rudely. I told this thing to find me an orb, and I was really rude. And the an orb came, but it was only about this big. It was a small orb. I thought, that's interesting, so I shoot it away. And then I asked politely, and then a large orb came. It was a different orb. And then I thought, well, what would happen if I had a large orb like this, and then I had held it in my hand, and then I insulted it? What would happen to it? So I held the orb in my hand, and I only did this once because I felt so bad about doing it, and I apologized afterwards for it. I held it in my hand, and I insulted it, and the whole thing shrunk down to just a wisp of energy right by my hand. This whole shell and everything, just the whole thing just kind of like folded up into a wisp of energy. What I wanted to see if it would go down to this size, to see if the one I had that was this size, is if it's the same one, but reacting to me. It didn't go down to this size. It went down to a wisp of energy, of cation energy. And it's interesting because a lot of the times that what people photograph as orbs is just a wisp. So that brings into question as to what exactly a wisp is. Is it an undeveloped orb? And I can get into this later on, but I really believe that there's many, many, many different types of orbs. But so that was interesting because so we found out that our words would change the size of this thing. And then it was interesting because I would hold it in my hand and I would check the ion charge of it. And then I would just test different words to see how it responded to it. For example, if I said yes, it would increase. If I said no, it would decrease. And so I had my wife, we were thinking this thing through. It's like, what words to try? And you can feel actually an energy that was coming through it, especially if you said yes, 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 and please and thank you and bless you. You could feel the energy coming through it. And she said, well, why don't you try more? So I said, more, and it decreased. I thought, what in the world? And it made me think that this thing is like a portal into a world where there is always enough. And so if I said more, I'm speaking from this side of the portal, not the other side of the portal. And this thing is kind of almost acts like a check valve, that stuff only flows one way. If I start talking in this world's language, it shuts down. If I start speaking in the language from where it's from, where it is connected to, then it starts to flow. Because this thing, well, you have to pardon me. I've got so much I want to say, and I don't know how to organize it all. So if I'm jumping around, I apologize. But this thing acts as a distributor field coming from another dimension, is how it appears to me, which is probably one of the reasons why it is interconnected with this thing. I also discovered that this orb does not like to pass through this field or the collector field that is down here. This orb can detect the energy and does not like to pass through it. This orb also does not like to pass through water. I took 2 cups of water and held the orb in my hand, and I pushed the orb toward the water, and it actually shrunk in size. And I thought, well, that's probably how it can get into my lungs, because it doesn't like to go into the body either. But if I inhale it, it can shrink itself down to a wisp and then go in, still with the full energy that it carries within it, but just not the shape. So it does not like to pass through the collector field or the distributor field. So I have a hunch this is a lot of people are saying that orbs are spirits from dead people or whatever. Like I said, there's many, many different types of orbs. This particular type that I'm dealing with here, I do not believe it has a personality. I do not believe, I do not believe it is a departed spirit. I believe it's a distributor field from another world. If I could use Christian terminology, from the kingdom of heaven, to a world where there's always enough. And so if I say more, that declares that there's not enough. And then I thought, well, what about the word revival? The word revival, shut it down. It doesn't like it. Because revival accentuates that something's dead. It needs to be revived. But if I say blessing, it opens up. If I say abundance, it opens up. Because where it is attached to, there's nothing dead, and there's no lack. So it is fascinating to learn and actually have this thing teaching me. It's kind of like that game, you're getting hotter, you're getting colder, getting hotter, getting colder, to locate something. So very, very fascinating. So to fire this thing up, we just say yes, 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 or bless you. I was testing it with scripture. And I had my phone out and I played scripture to it. And it energized it. And I thought, well, wait a minute. Is it the scripture itself, or is it faith maybe inside of me that's being stirred up? So I played the scripture on my phone. And then I took the orb out to the studio and shut the door and walked to the far end of the studio. And the energy field shut down. And I thought, well, that's interesting, because the scripture is still playing in the next room, but I can't hear it. And I remembered what the verse that says, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So it's the combination of the scripture being read and me hearing it. But okay, that's fascinating. It has to be both. And also, as a Christian, I can speak in tongues. And so one day I was testing the tongues, and I was speaking in tongues, and it fired up. And as I was speaking in tongues, I just felt something welling up inside of me, and I spoke in tongues louder, and it got more excited. And I thought, well, wait a minute, is it the volume, or is it something else? So then I thought, well, let's test this. So I started speaking in tongues to do this test, and then I increased the volume of it, and the thing shut down. And I thought, well, that's interesting. It's like it knows when it's flowing from the spirit, and it knows when it's flowing from my flesh. This is some really, really fascinating stuff. So the words, shut it down and open it up. Turn the power on, turn the power off. Now, let me go back to this, because I thought, well, maybe I'm a unique person that I can have this orb that's following me. So I got out this cone, or one similar to it, and I had my wife here, and I said, well, let's get you an orb. So I told her, I said, get an orb for my wife. And this thing did not fire. I thought, what in the world? I told it, get an orb for my wife. No field, nothing coming out. I thought, what is going on here? And then I remembered that when I was testing these things for how they can be affected by the subconscious, they would shut down if you asked a stupid question. So to me, this was a stupid question. I thought, well, why, what's going on here? And I thought, wait a minute, let me see if this thing is, monogamous. If once I have an orb with me, because there's so much I want to say. Let me go backtrack. The first day I had this thing, I called it in, and it took about a minute for it to come. The second day, it was about 30 seconds. The third day when I called it in, it was about 10 seconds. And every day after that, it got less and less and less time for this thing to come in. And what I began to wonder about was because I had an opportunity years ago to go to the revival that was occurring in Toronto, Canada, at the Airport Christian Fellowship. And the pastor, John Arnott and Carol Arnott, I had a special speaker there called, his name is Kubis van Rensburg from South Africa, was used in a lot of healings for people with AIDS and other things in South Africa. He was the special speaker. But anyway, one day after the service, the presence of God was just heavy in the place, really heavy, to where you could barely stand up. I mean, it was just, you just felt like you were just drunk in the spirit. And so I'm standing over to the side of the aisle, and John and Carol came down the aisle, followed by Quibus. And because when the Spirit of God is really, really heavy and present, you start to see things you normally cannot see with your natural eye. So John and Carol walked by, and I saw behind them, about a shoulder height, each of them had a golden orb behind them that was following them. John and Carol's was identical. And then Quibus walked by, and he had a 2-foot silver orb following him. And then the thing that was interesting was this, after he and the silver orb walked by, I was kind of just staring at these things, figuring out what they were. Something clipped me. The whole right side of me, it's like a big old linebacker struck my right side. Now, there's nobody around. But something hit me, and it drug its energy through me and then passed. I thought, what in the world was that? It was like a big old angel hit me. And I was kind of confused because the aisle was big enough where a big angel could go down without hitting me. I thought, was he rude or what? And then somebody told me that they had actually seen two angels following Quibus. So if two big old angels were following Quibus, then the aisle was not big enough for them and me. So one of them clipped me in the shoulder. As he went by, and my whole right side was just stinging after that. But so anyhow, we had John and Carol with the two golden orbs following them, Quibus with a silver orb following him, and then the two angels that were following following Quibus. So anyhow, I noticed that with these people, you know, who I very admire as probably the most spiritual people I know, had these orbs behind him about at shoulder height. And I thought, well, maybe this is what the saints, where they think about them having a halo. It's actually these orbs that are following behind. So anyhow, back to this illustration. So, you know, every day that I'm calling this thing in, it's taking less and less time for it to get into my hands. And I thought, well, where is this thing hiding at? You know, where is it staying? Is it going back up in the air? Where is it? So I set this thing and I pointed it. I just set it like this and I said, find my orb. And it went up and it went right into my chest, And then I turned and I checked and the orb was behind me at the shoulder height. So it's like, just like John and Carol had one each, Quibus had one, I now have one and he's staying behind my shoulders. So, okay, so I've got an orb that's attached to me, not, you know, attached. It's about 4 inches back, 4 to 6 inches behind my shoulder blades. So anyhow, so I go to call in one for my wife and it does nothing. And I thought, well, wait a minute, maybe after an orb attaches to you, it's monogamous and you cannot communicate with any other orbs Because when something like this doesn't fire, that means I asked it a very stupid question. So, okay. So then I told my wife, I said, you tell it to find you an orb. And it fired up. And it did the exact same thing. It went out the ceiling. And I told her to open up her hands and just say, orb, please come into my hand. And it was about a minute. And she had an orb in her hand. And it wasn't too long after that, the orb had attached to her. She tells it to find her an orb. And it finds her an orb. And it comes into her hands. And then after a very short time, it had attached itself to her about 4 inches behind her shoulder blades. And then I had another researcher friend of mine come over, and we got him an orb. They had to do the same thing. I could not get an orb for him. He had to command this thing to find him an orb, held out his hands, and it was about a minute, and the orb was in his hands, and not too long after that. And these are all Christians, so I don't know if that has any effect on it. But the orb had attached to him. And it was several weeks later, his wife had come over, and so we got an orb attached to her. So there's four of us testing out four orbs. All of ours are identical in size and in the fields. They're all of the 11-inch orb with the layering in them, cation charge, North Pole. All of them are identical. So this does make me also think that you know, these may actually be distributor fields. Okay, so where was I going with that? Anyhow, my friend, the other researcher, he had an orb attached to him. And so I thought, well, let's see how far away I can pull this thing with a magnet. So I have a domino magnet, and I stuck it to his orb that was behind him, and I started drawing it away, and I could actually draw it away 6 feet before it would snap back into its position behind his shoulder blades. And I did that several times, 6 feet, 6 feet. And then I pulled it out 4 feet, and I said, okay, tell this thing. I told him, I said, just tell this yes, yes, yes. So he said, yes, yes, yes. And at 4 feet, this thing snapped right back. It strengthened it, and it returned right back to its position behind his shoulder blades. So it's really fascinating, all the different things that we're discovering with this thing. The other thing that's interesting about this is that the orb resonates with love, joy, and peace. People that have been around, a lot of times they can feel the love and the joy and the peace that's resonating from the orbs when they're dancing around them, moving around them and stuff. And so I found this very, very fascinating, in the fact that when you use a distributor field like this, or a device like this, it will look for a genetic similarity or similar content. It will look for a cation charge, or it will look for what you give it a cognitive command for. So this is one thing that gave me a clue about this. If this resonates with love, joy, and peace, and people who photographed it said, where, you know, it just seems like when there's like a wedding, you'll see these things. Or when there's a joyful situation like music, you'll see these things. They'll end up in photographs. Where there's a peaceful situation, like around an animal or nature and stuff, you'll find these things. It's like wherever there's love, joy, and peace in the air, these things show up. And the other thing is, wherever there's spiritual activity, like a service, or a worship service, or things like that, that these things will show up. And they also will show up around children. Now, putting all these pieces together, it's like playing a game of Clue. We've got spiritual activity. We've got where there's love, joy, and peace in the air, and where there's children. Spiritual activity, love, joy, peace in the air, and children. Okay, let's put these together. What if this is a distributor field from a spirit to a child's heart, and the content of that distributor field, the origin, the spirit, is love, joy, and peace, that the spirit radiates love, joy, and peace. So genetic similarity would be spiritual, love, joy, and peace, and it would be looking for a child heart. Wait a minute, that is fascinating, because scriptures say that the kingdom of heaven belongs to the little children. And if you had the faith of a little child, you could say this mountain be cast into the sea and it would occur. And Jesus even talked about being born of the spirit, you know, about becoming a little child. And the scriptures talk about having an experience where you're crying out, Dada, where the child's heart within you is experiencing something. So I thought, wait a minute, spirit, love, joy, peace in the air in a child. And so that gives me the clue that this is probably the best I can figure out, is it's a distributor field from another dimension. Because if you look at this, what comes out of here is like a tube. It goes to its target. But what if its target is in a different dimension? Let's say that this is from another dimension, and it is going to something in our world, in our dimension. If this comes out, it is just like a tube that comes out, and it comes to our dimension and then punches through. And so it's quite likely that you would see then a sphere as it punches from one dimension to another, already at its target. And is, you know, so this is my hunch right now, that the orbs that we're dealing with, remember there are many, many different types, I believe, is a distributor field from another world, and it's just from another dimension. And it's interesting to see the language of more, it doesn't like it. Blessing, it opens up. More, it shuts down. Revival, shuts it down. Speaking in tongues opens it up. Scripture, hearing the scripture opens it up. And so it's really fascinating to see, to me, that this is like a distributor field coming from another dimension. And I would also recommend this book here, The Orb Project by Michael Ledwith and Klaus Heinemann. Very, very good book. And one of the things that it has in there is a lot of good photographs. And they talk about photographing orbs, and unfortunately they say that the new cameras, like this phone that I'm using here, have what's called a hot mirror in them that will actually make it very, very difficult to actually get a photograph of the orb, that it cuts out the energy fields that actually give you the field, because I tried many times to photograph the orbs, or the orb that I'm dealing with, and he's got a lot of really good pictures in it. And I recommend this book if you have an interest in it. But I've tried many, many times to photograph the orb that I'm dealing with and have not been able to. So if you want really good photographs, I would recommend this book. Really, really good information. Okay, well, let's keep going on here. The orb... I mentioned how I could breathe it into my lungs, or I could breathe it into my nose, and it would shrink down and then go into my lungs or into my nostrils, wherever I wanted. And it's interesting to get it into my nostrils and then to say yes, 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 and fire up its energy, because it like clears the brain and actually causes like spiritual insight. And it's almost as if, to try to figure out how to describe this, the orb is like a portal. It's like a distributor field. It's like a hole in the fabric that separates our world from another world. Or you could say it's a hole in the veneer of the substance, which it's a hole in the veneer of the illusion we call reality. Yeah, this thing would shrink, and I could bring it into my nostrils, and then I could fire it up with the words yes, 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 and it. Really, it's interesting. It like gives spiritual insight, gives you a sense of another dimension. But one night, I accidentally fell asleep with this thing still in my nostrils. And I had quite an experience in the morning. I woke up with this energy pulsing through me, and I'm just going, yes, 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 bless you, bless you, bless you, yes, 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 bless you, bless you. And it was like, if I didn't say it, I was going to explode with this energy. Like, oh, this is interesting. But it was for hours, just yes, 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 bless you, bless you, bless you, bless you. And I thought, this is crazy. I got to get some work done. I had to go to work. But it was like, yes, I had to just let this out or I was going to explode. Yes, 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 this positivity, this love, joy, peace, and positivity. And I found it interesting because got my truck going and headed down the road, and I noticed a nausea coming over me. And I thought, what in the world? What's this nausea? And I noticed I was having some negative thoughts and negative critical thoughts. And the effect of this was so strong in my system that if I had negative thoughts, it would make me nauseated. This is crazy. So, you know, that intense energy of positivity, of love, joy, and peace radiating from this thing. So that was quite an experience.
And I've never done that again. It's like, I can't handle that much energy. That was just insane. And so really, really, really very, very fascinating. But the other thing that was also interesting that makes this very similar to a distributor field is a distributor field, once it gets to something that it starts to distribute an anion charge into, then that target belongs to it alone. And so the fact that these are monogamous, that they take one person and that's it, you cannot communicate with any other orb, it's the same as this. It has the same effect as this. Also, this has a insulating skin, as just as this has an insulating skin, but where I can detect this one, I cannot detect this one. But this carries a anion charge, this carries a cation charge, but the cation charge does not transfer, which is really good to know. It actually creates an anion charge in water. And also when I push this toward glass or toward the glasses of water, the water picked up the same charge as the North Pole, the backside of this thing. So you can actually treat water with this by doing it that way, holding it up near water. But it did not want to pass through water. I mean, it will in certain situations. Like I had one time, I had this in my lungs, and instead of breathing it out, I just held up my hands and said, "Please come into my hands," and it actually went through my chest and then into my hands. It must have shrunk itself way down in order to do that. So fascinating, fascinating stuff. To describe what this thing is like, it's almost as if this is a relay satellite. If you think of it as a relay satellite that is sent from a creator of who flows in love, joy, and peace. This thing resonates in love, joy, and peace, and it attaches itself to the back. And it's interesting because it does not attach to the back behind the heart. It attaches itself to the back behind the heart chakra, as if this is a resonator which is trying to resonate love, joy, and peace into the heart chakra of an individual. So that is really, really fascinating. And I'm really starting to believe that what this thing is trying to do is trying to use the illustration of harmonics. If you take a tuning fork and it's here, and you have another tuning fork over here, and you strike this one will start to resonate because they're the same frequency. And this thing here is like a relay satellite. It comes behind you and resonates with love, joy, and peace from its origin. But the objective is to get your heart chakra to resonate to the love, joy, and peace that it is resonating with. And a lot of us have got junk from our past or things from our background or things that people have said that have stuck to us. That if you think of like a tuning fork, let's say if there's mud on a tuning fork, it will not resonate to the other tuning fork because the mud that is on it will cause it not to have the same frequency. Or if you're using bells or chimes, if they have debris on them, it will not resonate. It will not resonate with the other one. And a lot of us have got so much crud built up on us that we cannot resonate with the love, joy, and peace that is coming from the orb. And so I believe that the objective of this thing is to come in and to try to get us to resonate as closely as we can, and that will start to loosen up the crud from our past, the crud from our upbringing, the crud from what people have said, so that the love and joy and peace from a steady origin can resonate into our lives and then go out to others. Now, the other thing that's fascinating about this is that one day I was testing the orb, and these are reliable source of anions. If I have it going clockwise coming out, then I get anions off this side and cations off the other. So I was wanting to check to compare the cation charge here to the cation charge here. And I checked this when it was strong. I checked this and there was nothing. But wait a minute, nothing. Something is shutting this down. And it wasn't this, because this only shuts down if it's inside here. And I headed off to a distance, so I thought, well, maybe it's the ORBS that I have. So this only shuts down if it's inside here. So I thought, well, maybe it's some of the ORBS that I have around or some of the structured water. So I moved it away from all the structured water and ORBS and went to check it again. And there's nothing coming off of this. And I thought, well, wait a minute. Whatever is shutting this down might be coming off of me. So what I did is I stood this up and I walked away. And I found out that about 12 feet away, this thing would start to generate again. So I actually had a field around me, which was causing the almost like a superconductive field that was interfering with the EMF interface with the coil. So I thought, this was really interesting. It's actually the energy inside of me is creating a shield around me, an aura around me. Now I have to go back a little bit and explain here that when I first took the ORB and inhaled it into my lungs, it burned. And the first day it burned, the second day it burned, I only held it for about 5 seconds, third day it burned, and only 5 seconds and let it out. And I kept being impressed with the idea. It reminded me of when I made hydrogen generators, because the stainless steel plates, when you put it all together, you don't give it full voltage. What you do is only put a certain amount of electrolyte into it so that the amp draw is really low, and you let it run really low for a week or two. And what this does is it creates a catalytic layering on the plates so that they can handle more energy going through them. And when I first put the device together, I said, phooey on this, we're just going to crank it up. So I put a lot of electrolyte into my hydrogen generator and cranked it up, and the water turned black because it was actually burning the plates, dissolving the plates. And then I did my research and found out why, because I wasn't patient enough to do the slow development of the catalytic layering. So I thought, well, maybe this is the same thing. Maybe that this energy, I breathed it into my lungs and it burned. Maybe I don't have, as it were, the catalytic layering. Maybe this is like conditioning, that it has to rebalance the minerals, rebalance the mind, rebalance the heart, so that it can handle this type of energy that's flowing through here. So I hadn't given up completely about the possibility of inhaling the thing. It's just like, you better hold off for a while and see if you can deal with this slower. See if I can condition myself for that. And so then I tried to pay more attention to the love joint piece that was coming through the thing, trying to soak into that. And one of the other factors that I found is this thing will stay steadfast right behind your shoulders, but the more you soak up and resonate with the love joint piece that it gives, the more it is free to leave that position behind your heart chakra and come into your hands. Like for me, at first I would ask it to come into my hands, and I had to just keep asking it because it kept wanting to go back behind my shoulders. And I had to keep asking it and asking and asking it to stay there in order to do my research. But the more I soaked in the love joint piece that it was resonating with, then it would come into my hands and stay there for longer periods. And I should also say that we found that by having this energy, you could hold it up to your head, and if you moved it around your head, you would get different experiences. I like having it right in front of my forehead. I put my hand up onto my forehead. Let's turn this like this. Put my hand up here, and I asked the orb to come in. It come into my hand, and it would come into my hand, and the relaxation is just really, really, really deep. One of the other researchers that has an orb, he has his trained to sit on his shoulders. He said the energy is just very, very calming and peaceful as it radiates into the side of his head. I'm having it on top of my head. Just feels like you're getting a shower of warm energy over you. But the more we began to resonate with the love joint piece that this gives, the more it would leave its position behind the heart chakra and be able to work with us. As a matter of fact, my orb now, if I just hold out my hands like this, it will automatically move into my hand. I mean, even if I'm going to shake hands with somebody else, the orb will instinctively just move toward my hand. And that is, and I can actually feel it now. I feel a tingling when the orb is in my hands. But anyhow, so I breathed this in and it burned. It did it 3 days in a row and said, I better learn to condition, for a while and before I take this in. And so I tried to you know, low key, let myself be conditioned by this, by the love, joy, and peace that radiates from this thing. And then it got to the point where I could actually inhale the orb into my nostrils or into my lungs and hold it for longer periods of time. And if your orb is not fired up, if it's not energized, then you can hold it in for a long time because there's not much energy flowing. But if the energy is really flowing through it, it can burn if you're not conditioned for it. So anyhow, I started testing to see what it was like in my lungs, what it was like in my nostrils. In the nostrils, getting it fired up, and just started to sense and see things from another dimension, you know, as like a parallel dimension, a parallel worlds. You start to see these other things. But the thing that was fascinating was it also, because of that, not only started changing my mineral balances, but I got this shield around me that was about 12 feet out. And then sometimes I had it up to 24 feet where the I have to stand this up and then walk 24 feet away from it before the EMF interface would occur. And I just tested this today. I had the orb in my nostrils and I was saying yes, 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 and speaking in tongues to it. I had over 50 feet away before this thing would begin to resonate with the EMF. But people talk about being an atmosphere changer, about people who, when they walk into a room, the atmosphere changes. And it's interesting because this, the love, joy, and peace from an orb into the heart chakra, when you resonate with it, it goes out in that shield, in that field that runs around you. And right now, you know, I tested this today, it was about 50 feet out. So this might be actually what they're talking about, where the atmosphere of a room will change. Or you can just feel, sense, love, joy, and peace around a person because it does appear to radiate out in that field. So we are just beginning to understand this stuff and more to come. I need to point out that I have also been taking the Blue Water Alchemy ORMS. The milk and honey ORMS is what I've been taking, about a teaspoon a day. I've also been making my own using Dead Sea salt and Himalayan salt, using the wet method. And ORMS tends to make you more sensitive and receptive to energy fields, so I would not doubt that the rapidity, the speed at which I was actually able to assimilate the energy from the orb may have been aided by the ORMS. And I would recommend a teaspoon a day of a good ORMS if you want to experiment with the orb energy. Another thing is, you might be wondering why in the world I was inhaling the orb, because the orb in itself is designed and assigned to come in behind a person, behind the shoulder blades, about 4 to 6 inches back, and to resonate love, joy, and peace, the energy of love, joy, and peace, into the heart chakra. And over time, then the energy from the orb, if the person resonates with that frequency of love, joy, and peace, the energy will start to transfer into the person and transform them. Their ion fields, their ion levels, and also they will begin to resonate with the love, joy, and peace. But because I'm a lab rat and I didn't have time to deal with it slowly, I wanted to assimilate the energy quickly and to test it out, to see what it was, so I could do a report on it, and also to find out whether it was actually healthy or not, because I wasn't sure. And so that's why I inhaled it into my lungs and into my nostrils, and then fired it up to see what would happen. And one of the things that it did is it changed my ion level so fast I started detoxing and felt a little ill from it. So I do not recommend... I don't think this is how it was designed to affect a person, by inhaling it, but I did it for a test, and you can try it too, but I don't recommend it because it can actually change your mineral balances so fast that it can make you feel ill as it's detoxing and rebalancing. So that's the reason I was doing it. It's not natural with the orb. It's something a lab rat would do. But a few more thoughts about the frequencies. The orb resonates with love, joy, and peace. And in a way, it's kind of like, think about being on an airplane. The safety officer always comes up, the stewardess, they always give this spiel about in an emergency, like in a condition where they lose air pressure, these masks will drop down out of the overhead compartments. And you're supposed to extend the mask fully and then put it on your face and breathe normally. And this gives you oxygen. And in many ways, the orbs that people are seeing dancing around in the air and above them are like those oxygen masks that have dropped down from an overhead compartment. Many of these orbs that people see, I believe, are the orbs that we're dealing with that resonate with love, joy, and peace. But people do not know what to do with them. They see them dangling and dancing around and don't know that they're actually supposed to take the thing and put it on and breathe what the life that is coming through the orb. For us, it was very, very simple, just to set out the cement cone and to tell it to find an orb, and then to ask the orb to come into our hands, and then we would ask the orb to stay near us. And when we told the orb to stay near us, it would go and attach itself behind the shoulder blades. And then the thing was to resonate, to feel the love, the joy, the peace, and to resonate with it. And that's what it's like using that illustration of these oxygen masks coming down and then taking and putting it on and then breathing normal, breathing this life. Because it's like we live in a world where there's so little love, joy, and peace. It's like being on a plane that has a lack of oxygen, and these things are here to provide what is missing. And so we need to apply it. Something else, the love, the joy, and the peace, and I'll get into this later on, extrapolating more upon this, there is something very, very liberating about it. And I remember an article that I saw back at the turn of the century. There was a guy by the name of John Worrell Keeley who did studies in frequencies, and he discovered, among other things, that there were certain combinations of frequencies that you could get metals to resonate to, and they would shake off the connection of gravity. This is what he had discovered, and he made an umbrella, a thin metal umbrella with all these different metals on it, and he could take it out to a field and play this device. It was like a pipe organ. And the frequencies that he would play would cause the metals to resonate. And when the metals resonated to the frequencies, then they would lose their gravitational pull, and this thing would levitate. And it appeared to be a legitimate thing, and I don't know if the military is using it now or has used it. I do not know. But the illustration is what I'm after, is that when we resonate with the love, the joy, and the peace that the orb, this relay satellite, is trying to pump into us, there's a type of flight that occurs, a weightless flight, when a person knows that they're at the very core of their being, that they are loved, that they have value, that they have worth, that they're affirmed, that they're secure. It casts off all the junk. As the scripture says, that perfect love casts out fear. It casts out the shame, too, that we've grown up with. And the peace that comes, the peace, there's so much of life that is worrisome. And this perfect peace that comes through the orb shoves that aside. It overcomes it. And the joy that comes through the orb, the joy overwhelms the sorrow of the past and the pain and the disappointment from relationships. The joy takes care of that. So this love, this joy, this peace that is resonating through the orb has a way of liberating a person from from the bondages of this life and literally allowing them to soar, if you could say, in a spiritual sense. So the thing that it is here for is to bring us love, joy, and peace that we cannot find in this world, because you cannot find the love that you're after through another person. You cannot find a validation of your worth through accomplishing things, through money, through possessions. You cannot find joy through parties and drugs or anything else. You cannot find peace anywhere else. But there's a perfect love, joy, and peace resonating through the orb that we are designed to resonate with. So this is the thing that I've been working on, and we'll keep studying it, we'll keep working on it. But thank you for listening, and talk to you later. Bye.